Yeah, I think this is a little bit liquidy.
We failed.
Her papas would be so disappointed.
First try, we failed.
You've said that it's the failures that have really kind of shaped you.
Yeah.
Specifically, when you look back, what were some of these moments?
You know, along every path, there was something that didn't work out. And so, you know, I'll talk, like, when we built the business of SnapSaves, the company that was bought by Groupon, I mean, that wasn't the original idea. The original idea was, well, we knew customers wanted, you know, discounts on consumer packaged goods product and groceries when they went shopping. And so we started with a print-at-home website. We started doing samples that were mailed to your door. We tried a bunch of different things until we finally got, you know, the app and the interface that worked really well. I actually don't think of them as failures because you learn. In every failure, something is working a little bit. And so you take that 20% of what's working and you just keep doubling down on it.
I mean, there has to come a moment where you kind of step back and think, maybe I shouldn't keep trying. Yeah. Was there ever that moment for you?
There's lots of moments like this where you're like, this could be a lot easier. I could do something a lot more stable. You have to get excited about the idea of disrupting an industry. And that really keeps you going because you're like, the status quo isn't good enough. But I mean, do you feel like, you know, depressed and like this is difficult and like you're never gonna make it at times? Absolutely. And I think that's where like good business partners and a good, really close circle of friends is you know, so important.
You're doing so well, but you're so young. I mean, like, do you even realize, you know, what you've done or?
So here's the little secret. When you're an entrepreneur, things are constantly going wrong. And so it's almost impossible.
But not for you.
No, that's not true. It's almost impossible to get an inflated ego, right? Like as you're growing and operating a business, you know, you have people quit on you, you have a product not working, you have a goal to get to market and you don't reach that. Every week, two things are gonna blow up. I just have no idea what those are. I can't pre-anticipate them, I can't pre-see the problem. And so I think part of the nice thing about this career is that it really humbles you.
I'm wondering whether or not you see there is a difference between female startups receiving capital or having access to capital versus males.
This is a very hot topic today. I'm a big believer that great ideas, you know, get funded and grow no matter what gender or race or ethnicity you come from. Have we seen a difference? I think this is way more dominant in the venture capital industry, where less than 2% of VC dollars go to female founders. Even two generations ago, you know, my options, having this personality, being just genetically ambitious would have
amazing
been.
Amazing you.
Would have been, well, not amazing, just me, right? You all have to deal with whatever, you know, comes out of your own genetic makeup. But I would have gone crazy. I mean, my options would have been, you know, be a school teacher or be a secretary. And today, I mean, I've gotten to build five different companies. I've gotten to be taken seriously by global brands in the world. I've gotten to launch some awesome initiatives. Like, that option didn't ever exist for me before. And so I don't think that's to say we stopped trying. I just think to say we have made very big strides in, you know, generations that you and I can think about.
As the youngest dragon, what advice do you have for these entrepreneurs that come in?
You have to do a lot of practice of the first eight things you're gonna say. And it's like this with any pitch, right? I still, to this day, people don't believe this, but like when I have an important pitch meeting, we still role play the whole thing. We'll go through every hard question you can ask me and how we should talk about that. It's that process that makes you really good. It's that process that makes, and people don't believe that I still practice and I still do this, but we do it all the time.
I wanna take it back now, and you're wearing this Ukrainian outfit, which is beautiful.
Thank you.
What's your background?
So I'm half Ukrainian and half Slovak.
I knew that. Do you know how to make vareniki or pierogies?
I'm a little rusty, but I was taught as a kid by my baba. And oh, so this so is so fun.
Maybe you can teach me a thing or two.
Of course.
Two cups of flour.
Okay.
Three eggs. Okay. So we're making the dough, some salt, and water.
Yep, two cups of water.
We need more flour.
Yeah, we need more flour.
Is it thickening up?
Oh yeah,
Oh yeah, that just got a lot harder to stir.
I think I'm gonna take it out now. What do you think? Oh, okay, we're getting there now.
Yeah, we're getting there.
Look at you, you really know how to knead dough.
So, old training dies hard, right?
What are some of the craziest pitches you've heard on the show at Dragon's Den?
Oh my goodness. You know, the craziest ones to me are always where people say, I've had this idea for 10 years. And you kind of look at them and you go, like, what have you been doing? 10 years ago, there wasn't an iPhone. Like, you have to act on your idea. Our babas would be like, guys, I taught you a little bit better. There we go.
Oh, there you go. Looking good. Tell me about some of the dragons.
I got to meet Arlene this season. She's incredible. Joe is, and I are quite close friends. I mean, Weck is always up for a party and a good time. So Baba told me not to overstuff.
No, and I just overstuffed.
And then the trick.
What's the trick,
Michele? Is then to get all the air out when you're doing this.
Ta-da!
Oh my God.
How does that look?
That's beautiful. And that's the fun part about the show is sometimes, you know, we got to deal these guys that were doing this last mile delivery company came on and Jim told them, you know, you could never use crowd-funded labor to do order a pizza. And then, you know, a year later, we helped them close a deal with Walmart. And so now if you order 1 hour delivery on Walmart, it's them that's delivering it. And so it's like clearly the model worked.
Should we boil them?
We should boil them, yeah.
Okay.
We got some boiling water here ready.
Careful, careful.
And then we're waiting for them to
rise to
float
the top.
To the top.
Yeah. Please float. Please float.
Please float.
Did I hear you say they're ready?
They're ready.
Oh, they're so plump.
They're so big.
The money shot.
The money shot. Here we go.
A little bit of sour cream.
Yep. Some of this.
I know I'm okay, but I'm gonna maybe have some of these caramelized onions. Smashed normal.
They're so good.